In the first age of Arda, as the Noldor elves spread throughout Beleriand, they waged war against the Dark Lord Morgoth. After his defeat at Dagor Aglareb, Morgoth retreated to the fortress of Angband. Yet the forces of the elven lords lacked the strength to assault his stronghold directly and end the threat entirely, and so they focused on containing his evil while they settled their people. Under High King Fingolfin, the lands of Dorthonion came to be ruled by his nephews, the sons of Finarfin, Angrod and Agnor, while the northeastern realm of Ladros was held by their human allies in the House of Beor, one of the three tribes of the Edain, who journeyed west over the Blue Mountains and now made their home in Beleriand. For 400 years, there was relative peace as the Dark Lord Morgoth was held off at the Siege of Angband. But after centuries of waiting, Morgoth at last unleashed his power upon them, bursting forth from the walls of his fortress with rivers of flame, burning the elven armies and surrounding lands. He then unleashed his monstrous armies upon Beleriand in the Dagor Bragollach, which saw the Dark Lord conquer much of the north, including the lands of Dorthonion, killing Angrod and Agnor. The Lord of Ladros, Bregolas, was also killed in the fighting, but his younger brother Barahir survived, even leading a small group of his bravest men near the Fen of Serech, saving the life of the elven lord Finrod, who swore an oath of friendship to the House of Beor, giving Barahir the Ring of Felagond as a symbol of this vow. Although the lands of Ladros were soon lost as well, Barahir refused to leave the land uncontested, and so sent his wife to lead the women and children away, while the warriors remained to defend their homes. Barahir and his people fought valiantly, but in the end only the chieftain remained, along with 12 companions, including his son and heir, Beren. Yet still, their resolve did not waver, and they lived as outlaws in the wilderness, attacking Morgoth's forces whenever possible. Then one day, as one of their companions, later known as Gorlim the Unhappy, was off on a hunt near to where he once lived, he suddenly saw his wife moving about their old home, alive and well. Having thought her dead, he rushed out from his place of hiding and ran to her, only to be apprehended by the forces of the Maia Sauron, lieutenant of Morgoth. Gorlim, beset with grief and longing, made a deal with Sauron, betraying the location of his companions in exchange for being reunited with his wife. As a result, Barahir and his people were slaughtered at Tarn Eluin, killing all except Beren, who was off running an errand for the group at the time of the massacre. Sauron then revealed to Gorlim that the woman he'd seen was a specter and that his wife was long dead. He then put Gorlim to death, thereby keeping his word of reuniting the couple. With his father and companions gone, Beren lived alone in the wilderness for a time, becoming a friend to the animals of the forest. He ate no meat and killed nothing save for the followers of Morgoth he encountered. Yet as the bounty on his head increased, life in the north became more difficult, and so he made his way south into Doriath, and there, traveling through the forests, encountered an elven maiden so beautiful he fell in love upon first glance. For he had laid eyes upon Lúthien Tenúviel as she danced and sang, daughter of King Thingol of Doriath and Queen Melian the Maia. This princess of the hidden kingdom of the Sindar elves was often claimed to be the most beautiful maiden to ever exist. With a voice so beautiful, snows melted when she sang, and an aura so pure, spring followed her as she walked. Lúthien, entranced by this stranger, allowed him to come close and felt herself in love, but then suddenly ran off, frightened by her unexpected feelings, causing Beren to collapse and sink into a void of despair. Yet soon she returned to once again look upon the man who'd touched her heart. And while they seemed so unlikely a match, Beren and Lúthien fell madly in love, with the princess often journeying into the forest to meet with him in secret. But Beren was not the only one pining for the affections of the daughter of Thingol, for there was also Daeron the minstrel, who often played his flute for Lúthien as she danced in the forest. Daeron was so determined to be with her, he began to spy upon her movements, discovering her secret meetings with the human and reporting her activities to the king. Summoned before Thingol and Melian, Beren was so struck by the grandeur and splendor of the elven halls and their lords, he could not speak, but after a moment found his courage and spoke with pride as a chieftain of the House of Beor. He told the king and court of his family lineage and presented them the Ring of Felagond, demonstrating the friendship his father had earned from a prince of the Noldor elves. And while this impressed many, Thingol was offended by the idea that his precious Luthien would marry a human, and therefore devised an impossible task that he demanded as bride price for the hand of his daughter. Before all, the king decreed that Beren must retrieve a Silmaril jewel from the Iron Crown of Morgoth and return it to Doriath in order to be deemed worthy of marriage to Luthien. Although this was clearly meant as a death sentence for the man, Beren accepted the price and said farewell, vowing to return with the jewel in his hand. Melian, Queen of Doriath, and Amaya of Valinor spoke little during the meeting, but afterwards warned her husband that involving himself and the kingdom with the Silmarils would bring doom upon them all, for the sons of Feanor had long ago vowed to retrieve the Silmarils at any cost and would never allow King Thingol to take possession of one of the jewels. Yet events were now in motion that could not be stopped, with Beren traveling west to Nargothrond and meeting with the now High King Finrod Felagund,
who recognized him at once and did not need the ring for verification.
Finrod, bound by the oath he gave to Barahir, agreed to help Beren in his mission to retrieve the Silmaril, but in doing so caused great uproar and dissension within his realm, for the sons of Feanor were highly influential and powerful Noldor, with many friends and allies that would follow them into rebellion should they turn against the High King. And so when Finrod announced his plans to travel with Beren, Celegorm and Curufin openly objected, convincing the realm not to wage war against Morgoth for such a cause. Finrod, seeing his own people turn against him, removed his crown, unwilling to break the oath made to the House of Beor, and left the realm with Beren and a small group of loyal companions, fully aware that by leaving his crown behind, he risked losing his kingdom to the sons of Feanor. On the way to Angband, they encountered a party of orcs and slew them, taking their weapons and armor. Then Finrod used his magic to change their appearance so they might look like orcs for the rest of their journey. However, Sauron became alerted to their presence when he noticed a party of orcs moving about the lands without reporting their activities, as was the duty of all servants of Morgoth. And so he came upon them, only to be confronted by Finrod, who engaged the Dark Lord in a wondrous battle, each using their magic to sing songs of power, clashing in a piercing and treacherous sway of lethal force. And while Finrod was strong and determined, he could not match the power of Sauron, and was defeated and captured along with Beren and their companions. They were then thrown into a dungeon of darkness, where the only things they sometimes saw were the glowing eyes of a werewolf coming to devour one of the prisoners. Sauron believed this would encourage them to reveal their purpose for traveling into these lands, but none of the companions betrayed their king. When only Finrod and Beren were left, the werewolf again came, but Finrod summoned the last of his strength and burst forth, breaking his chains and slaying the beast with his hands and teeth, suffering fatal wounds in the struggle. Having fulfilled his oath to the House of Beor, Finrod said goodbye to his friend Beren with his final words, aware that they would likely never see each other again, for the fate of elves and men differed, and while Finrod would be reborn someday, humans were destined to leave the world. And so died the High King of the Noldor, leaving Beren in horrible grief, alone in the darkness. Far from the shadowlands of the Dark Lord Morgoth, Luthien, Princess of Doriath, felt the terrible pain of her beloved Beren as he withered away in Tol Un-Gaurhoth, Sauron's deadly island fortress. At once she wished to come to his aid, enlisting the help of her friend Daedon the minstrel, but he betrayed her, revealing her plans to Thingol and commissioning the creation of a beautiful house within a large tree, housing Luthien there and removing any way for her to leave the home. But she refused to abandon Beren and used magic to grow her hair long, then using it as material to make an enchanted robe, cast with a spell, placing any who looked upon her to sleep. She also fashioned a rope, using it to climb down and escape. While traveling through the forest, she was discovered by Huon, the wolfhound of Valinor, once a hunting companion of the Vala Orome, who'd been made ageless, tireless, and sleepless, even granted the gift of speech, though was only allowed to speak 3 times during his life. It was prophesied that Huon could only be killed by the greatest wolf that ever lived. When the Noldor elves still lived in Valinor, Orome gave Huon to his friend Celegorm, son of Feanor, to protect him and serve by his side. Huon was so powerful, the spell of Luthien had no effect on him, and so he brought the elf maiden before his master. Celegorm and Curufin, who'd been opposed to Finrod's journey with Beren, then used the situation to their advantage. Struck by her beauty and seeing the tremendous merits in marrying the daughter of King Thingol, Celegorm sent a letter to Doriath telling them of Luthien's arrival and of their impending marriage. Yet so lovely a creature was Luthien that even the hound Huon loved her, and so he spoke for the first time, helping her escape from captivity. When they arrived at Tol Ín Gaurhoth, Luthien sang a song that could be heard throughout the area. It even reached Beren as he wallowed in the darkness of his prison. The man then summoned the last of his strength and sang his own song, which Luthien heard. But Sauron too learned of her location and sent his werewolves to stop her. One by one, Huon battled and tore apart these enemies, until Sauron sent Dragluin, first and oldest of their kind, and he engaged in a great battle with Huon, but could not best him, and so Dragluin fled, escaping back to his master and warning him of Huon's presence before dying from his injuries. Sauron then took the form of a werewolf and went to confront the beast himself, engaging in yet another terrible battle, transforming into a snake and his own form during the fighting. But still Huon would not relent, defeating the Lord of the Isle and forcing him into surrender. Yet as soon as Huon released him, he changed form into a bat and flew away. Luthien then searched and found Beren in his prison, and the two were at last reunited. They then buried Finrod and left the area. Huon the Hound, satisfied that he'd done his duty to Luthien, returned to Nargothrond to continue serving Celegorm, though the son of Feanor no longer had the same love for the creature he'd once felt. In addition to Huon, many of the prisoners Luthien had freed returned to Nargothrond, and as they were loyal to the deceased King Finrod, persuaded the Noldor that the sons of Feanor had evil in their hearts and were wrong to have spoken against the king. And so both Celegorm and Curufin were banished from the realm, sent to find refuge with their brothers in the east. Beren, meanwhile, continued on his mission to claim a Silmaril, and while he desired that Luthien remain behind or return to Doriath for her own safety, she outright refused, insisting that they not be parted. Yet once again, conflict found them, as the sons of Feanor happened upon them in the forest, and again tried to steal Luthien away. Although Huon the Hound once again turned on his master during the engagement, protecting Beren and Luthien, Beren was gravely injured while diving in front of his beloved, taking an arrow in the chest for her protection. Huon then chased the sons of Feanor away and returned with a special herb, which added to the magic of Luthien, saved Beren's life. Continuing on their journey, Huon brought them the skin of the werewolf Draugluin and the bat fell, Thuringwethil, speaking for the second time and advising that they use them as disguises, then saying goodbye because he could go no further. As they traveled into Angband, Luthien also used her magic to put any who gazed upon them to sleep. Even Karkaroth, servant of Morgoth and the most powerful werewolf to ever exist, fell to her enchantment as he looked upon them. Beren and Luthien then snuck through the fortress of Angband into Morgoth's chamber, and even the Dark Lord could not resist Luthien's spell, entranced by her beauty and put to sleep by her magic. Beren then cut a Silmaril from the Iron Crown, and was so elated by his success, he attempted to take a second Silmaril in the hopes of collecting all three. However, his blade broke as he cut the second jewel, causing a shard of steel to cut Morgoth's cheek, stirring him from sleep. Beren and Luthien, forgetting about the other jewels, then hastily made their way out of the fortress. However, Karkaroth, now awoken, confronted them as they escaped, and so Beren pulled out the Silmaril, hoping its brilliant light would scare the creature away. The werewolf instead bit off Beren's hand, swallowing the Silmaril, and immediately turned to madness as it burned his insides. Karkaroth went on a rampage, ignoring Beren and Luthien, just as all of Angband awoke, threatening to destroy them. But then the eagles of Manwë arrived, after Huon the Hound spread word for the animals of the forest to keep watch on the couple. The eagles carried the man and elf maiden to safety, while Luthien's magic again saved Beren's life. The couple, having ended their mission in failure, then returned to Doriath, presenting themselves before the king and telling of their astonishing adventure. Although Beren had not succeeded in bringing back the Silmaril, Thingol was marveled by the story, seeing clearly that this was no ordinary human and that indeed he was worthy of marrying his daughter. With Beren now accepted among them, the king organized a great hunt, traveling into the forests of Doriath to slay the beast Karkaroth, who was slaughtering everything in his path. Alongside the king, Beren joined the hunt, along with Huon the Hound and many other lords and heroes of Doriath. As they searched for the creature, Karkaroth was the first to attack, leaping out to kill the king. Yet Beren leaped before him with a spear, which was knocked aside as the creature bit into the human's chest. Huon then charged forth against the werewolf, engaging in a vicious battle as Beren lay dying. And while Karkaroth was defeated, Huon suffered terrible injuries, using the last of his strength to walk over to Beren and lay by his side, speaking for the third and final time to bid farewell before dying. One of Thingol's men then cut open the werewolf beast and removed the Silmaril, placing it in Beren's hand so he might fulfill his vow and present the jewel to the king. Although Beren was so badly injured he could no longer speak, he held on to life just long enough to gaze upon Luthien one last time before dying. As was the fate of men, Beren's spirit was transported to the halls of Mandos, where he would wait for a time before leaving the world entirely. Yet even before the mighty Valar, Beren was steadfast, refusing to proceed into the afterlife until he saw Luthien again and said a proper goodbye. Luthien, meanwhile, could not live without his love, and so died shortly after Beren, her spirit then going to the halls of Mandos to be among the elves who would be reborn in Arda. There, she sang a beautiful song of sorrow, which moved Mandos to pity. And so he went to seek counsel from Manwë, Lord of the Valar, who consulted with their creator Eru to determine the fate of Beren and Luthien. And so Luthien was offered a choice. Either she could continue on to the elven afterlife, or else she could be reborn alongside Beren in Middle-earth, destined to live a mortal life and share in the fate of men. Rejecting the gift of immortality, she chose to live a life with Beren, and so they spent the rest of their time together, living in Tol Galen of Osiriend, and having a son they named Dior, who would be the heir of King Thingol. Dior was believed to be one of the most beautiful beings to ever live, because in his veins ran the blood of men, elves, and even the Ainur through his grandmother Melian. Only once more did Beren involve himself in the affairs of Beleriand, gathering together a group of green elves and ents to ambush the dwarves of Nogrod, who destroyed Doriath and killed King Thingol, stealing from him the necklace Nauglamir. Once Thingol was avenged and the treasure recovered, Beren gave the beautiful prize to his wife Luthien, and the two continued to live together for many years, dying a peaceful death at the same time in their old age. For thousands of years, the tale of Beren and Luthien inspired and enthralled the peoples of Middle-earth, standing as a shining example of a love so strong, none could stand between them. Further, it was the first known marriage between a human and elf, creating a bloodline that would endure until the end of the world.
A special thanks to all those who contribute to Civilization X,
like Sami the Fair Beaudhag, Arhael the Silent Blade, and Sir Daeron of House Ashford.
If you would like to help Civilization X, click on the Patreon link, and please be sure to like and subscribe, and click on the links to see more.